morning and welcome to the 30th meeting in 2022 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have apologies this morning from Michelle Thompson, who is unwell, and Daniel Johnson, who is submitting amendments at another committee meeting this morning. Before we move on to our first item of business today, I want to put on record my thanks to all those who organised, supported, attended and participated in the Joint Taxation Conference hosted yesterday by the Royal Society of Edinburgh. And what was a very interesting day, I know committee members will have heard lots of ideas about proposals to inform our consideration of potential areas of future work on taxation. We'll come back to consider these formally at a later date. Turning to the first item on today's agenda, we now take evidence from the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth on the Budget Scotland Act 2022 Amendment Regulations 2023 Draft. And Mr Arthur is joined today by Scottish Government officials Niall Caldwell and Craig Maidment. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite Mr Arthur to make a short opening statement. Minister.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. The autumn budget revision provides the first of two opportunities to formally amend the Scottish Budget for 2022-23 and contains the usual four categories of changes. The funding changes increase the budget by £691.5 million. These changes include £290 million of cost of living measures the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy outlined as part of Stage 3 of the Scottish Budget in March. The technical adjustments primarily relate to IFRS 16 adjustments. These are essentially budget neutral and do not impact the spending power of the Scottish Government. We have a net positive impact of £106.5 million on the overall aggregate position. It is necessary to reflect these adjustments to ensure that the budget is consistent with the accounting requirements and with the final outturn that will be reported in our annual accounts. Whitehall transfers total £7.9 million, and the final part of the budget revision concerns the transfer of funds within and between portfolios to better align the budgets with profiled spend. The supporting document to the autumn budget revision and a finance update prepared by my officials provides background on the net changes. £94 million of the total funding we have received is not allocated in the budget revision. However, this funding has been held against a number of commitments embedded within our financial forecasts. The Deputy First Minister has been clear in the emergency budget review that we still face a number of budgetary challenges this year. This funding has been held as a necessary step to ensure we can balance the inflationary pressures on our budget within the constraints that we face. The finance update provides further detail of the effect of the EBR on our budget process and the wider fiscal context in which we have to operate. And on that, Convener, I will conclude and be happy to answer any questions at the committee.
That's great. Well, thank you very much for the opening question. Just one thing that came up when we had a wee discussion before you came, which was just about the autumn budget revisions and the guide. They're not published at the same time, which causes a wee bit of difficulty. I'm just wondering if in future the guide can be published at the same time as the papers. It allows members to reflect a lot more easily and early on in the process.
I'm happy to take that away, Convener, and see what we can do in that area. And indeed, if there's anything more broadly that the committee would like to discuss with regards to the content of the paper, again, happy to do so. I want to ensure we can provide as much information and as timely a manner as possible.
Yeah, I mean, we realise that because of the kind of political flux that has actually been at Westminster, it's not been as easy perhaps to produce these figures, and perhaps there's a bit more complexity in them than one would normally expect. Now, just on the technical adjustments, actually, we do actually have an explanation of that, of course, in our papers, but I'm just wondering if you can tell us a wee bit more about it for the record.
Certainly, well, as I outlined in my statement, I say so we are compliant. I think of the £106 million, the overwhelming majority of it is to comply with IFRS 16. But given this is a technical matter regarding to accounting charges, I'm going to ask Neil if he wants to offer any further comment.
So it's mainly about leases being capitalised onto the balance sheet. So all of the transfers that we require to process for that, we receive budget cover for through the estimate process. So it is essentially budget neutral, as the Minister said in the remarks. So it will still be classified, there'll be capital, and there'll be depreciation or non-cash ring-fenced budget for it, but in the overall context, it's budget neutral.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Now, you talked in your opening statement, for example, about social justice, housing and local government and the additional funds that have been allocated in there. But one of the second largest allocation of £180 million relates to police and fire pensions, which has been added to the Justice and Veterans portfolio. And it says this is a volatile demand-led budget with additional budget pressures beyond the core allocation managed in year, which I think is fair enough, but it's 6% of the budget. It seems quite a lot of money not to have been anticipated. One would have thought that something such as police and fire pensions was indeed something that one could anticipate fairly early on.
Well, it very much is, Convener, a volatile and demand-led area, and it is subject to significant change throughout the financial year. Final costs are heavily dependent upon the number of retirees in one financial year. So that means that there is significant uncertainty until the end of the financial year. If I maybe just give a bit more information for context, following the 2021-22 spring budget revision, where additional budget was provided, a £30 million underspend was subsequently reported at provisional outturn. And this, I think, illustrates the uncertainty we have in accurately forecasting these costs. We do expect to see further volatility with a higher than anticipated number of retirees in the current year, so further budget may be required as part of the spring budget revision to fully fund the position. So I think just from the picture from previous years and as we're seeing in year, it is demand-led, it is volatile, and that's why we manage it through the budget revision process.
But surely if you know how old a firefighter or a police officer are, you'll have a rough idea when they're going to retire. A pretty precise idea when they're going to retire, generally speaking.
Well, it can depend upon a number of factors about the decisions that individuals take in particular context. But as I say, the actual amount is required to meet that need. It is demand-led, and the point I made with regards to last year where additional funding was allocated but it came through as a £30 million underspend, I think illustrates that point.
Okay. What I found interesting actually was the fact that Transport Scotland were allocated an additional £22 million of funding for free travel for under-22s, but then that was in paragraph 17, but then in paragraph 23, £20.7 million released from the concession affairs to reflect lower than expected demand. So I'm just wondering, you know, the net effect of that's £1.3 million, of course, but I'm just wondering why it seems awful clumsy to say, well, we gave this department £22 million and then we actually took £20.7 million off it. Would it not be easier just to provide, to explain that we actually, the £1.3 million change?
Well, as you identify within the document, the net change of £1.3 million is what is down, but the additional £22 million was a targeted carry forward from the reserve at the start of the year. And clearly, with updated information and seeing that demand is not what was originally predicted, that's why the return's taking place.
Okay. Now, this every year since for many years we ask the question about the transfer from health and social care to education and skills to pay teaching grants for nursing and midwifery students, and that's £64 million. So the question is why. Do we have this transfer every year? Why is it not just put into the education and skills budget in the first place?
Well, I think it's a question of what policy area does the fund support and then what policy area delivers it. So you give the example of £64 million for nursery and midwifery. Clearly that is something that's contributing towards outcomes within the health portfolio, but it is delivered through the education portfolio. The other examples that I'm sure you will identify are around, for example, free school meals, summer activities provision, which sit within the education portfolio, education skills, but are delivered through local government, hence that transfer. So
transfers, of course, but it's just that if every year it's going to be transferred, then it seems daft, I think, to have it in the wrong, it's clearly in the wrong portfolio to start off with. I mean, it doesn't make any sense to have money allocated to a specific budget when this time next year we'll probably be asking the same question. Why is it not in the education and skills budget? I mean, I suspect the real reason, but I'm just wondering if you can give me a financial reason why that is.
I think it provides clarity, because I can imagine that if we were discussing the autumn budget revision, but if we were discussing the actual budget as introduced, we would want maximum clarity. So were these funds, for example, to be within the education and skills portfolio when it's clearly achieving a health outcome? The question might be, well, why is that not in the health portfolio? Because we want to provide as much clarity as possible. So it's part of the health spend, but in terms of how it's actually delivered, that's why the transfer takes place.
Right, we'll have to agree to differ on that one. I don't really think that's the real reason. But anyway, we shall leave it at that. I'm sure if others want to explore it, they can, if they so wish. And there remain a number of significant potential budget pressures that are not yet fully quantified, including key public sector staff groups where pay agreements have yet to be settled. So what are those other potential budget pressures other than pay increases?
There's clearly a huge degree of volatility and uncertainty. I think I would probably just highlight, for example, the Ukraine resettlement. Again, there is uncertainty about where we will land there. It could be in the region of 200 million. So given the overall inflation, set of inflationary pressures that we face, given the uncertainty that we face as well with regards to where we will finally land in total costs around public sector pay, it's already 700 million, over 700 million indicated through the EBR. There is a great degree of uncertainty. Mm-hmm. So again, I touched on earlier with regards to pensions, the need to potentially revisit this again at SBR. So there remains a significant amount of uncertainty in our position.
Yeah, I mean, I really sympathise with your position. I can understand how frustrating it is, this level of uncertainty you're having to deal with, Minister. I mean, one of the things that the presentation we've been given doesn't provide is a full breakdown of the Scottish Government funding envelope by source, nor reflect the full forecast position for the remainder of the year. So I'm just wondering why that is the case.
Well, I would refer the committee to Annex A of the supporting document, which sets out the funding envelope and source of fundings.
All right, can you expand on that just now?
Certainly. So it's Annex A in the guide, mm-hmm, and Annex B for capital. So we've provided an indication there. We've set out what the 22-23 budget position was, the confirmed changes at ABR, and the revised position. And that includes at the foot of the table the funds that remained unallocated for resource, capital and FT.
So it should be the final two pages in the guide document that the committee was sent. It's a line-by-line analysis.
Okay, thanks for that.
And there's commentary, I should say, as well, convener, preceding the tables.
And just one more thing for me, and it's about capital, basically, which is that just a wee bit of concern, and I think other committee members have this concern also, which is about capital is obviously normally, and capital can't be used for day-to-day resource spending, but it certainly appears from the figures that we've been provided with that the savings of around £150.1 million have been made in the capital budget. Is it the intention to spend that on resource? Because normally money in from capital is not spent that way on, for example, mm-hmm, salaries, etc., etc. We've seen it go the other way. You know, we've seen resource go into capital, but it's not really something we see very often. It's not really.
Given the circumstances that we face, we are seeking that flexibility from the UK government.
Okay, but I know you're seeking that flexibility because it's not normally permitted. Have you any indications as to whether it will be?
Well, we're still awaiting confirmation from the UK government. But it's a flexibility that we are seeking.
Okay. Now, in terms of where that £150.1 million is drawn from, there's, you know, £60.9 million from Net Zero Energy and Transport, for example, Rural Affairs and Islands, Social Justice, Housing and Local Government. And in terms of the latter, £10 million would be reduced from housing capital projects. Now, given the accelerating level of inflation we've seen, which is higher than the general inflation, in the retail price index that we've seen in construction, £10 million from that. What impact would that have on the affordable housing programme?
Well, Ultimately, these budgets and changes that we make reflect demand, and you made reference to the NZ budget where there's been reductions in the energy line. That's ultimately just a reflection of where demand is at presently, and that's impacted by a number of factors, general economic conditions and the legacy of the pandemic, supply chain issues, for example. So there's a number of factors which impact upon demand. And in this particular case, the energy line, for example, that money has been released back to the centre. I don't know if there's anything you want to come in on specific, Anil.
I suppose just in terms of timing. So the benefit of processing some of those returns of capital early were to ensure that the £120 million for local government capital could be included. Mm-hmm. So generally there's a level of timing and certainty about what you include in a budget revision at this stage in the year and what you don't. So that was the main reason for those being included at this time of year.
Okay, and in terms of the education skills, the reduction there is £40 million from what it calls education capital projects. So what capital, education capital projects will be impacted by that?
I'd be happy to come back to the committee in more detail on that. I don't have it in front of me right now.
That's one of the savings that was included as part of the EBR exercise, so it's not in the budget revision as it stands.
Yes.
And just lastly on this capital issue, I mean, energy capital projects, for example, are £15 million. You hope to be able to transfer from that, and you talk about demand. Is it? When you say demand, does that mean there's not demand from industry, from the public, or is there a shortage of, for example, skilled workers to deliver some of these capital projects? Why is there this loss of demand? Because my understanding is that demand is high right across the economy for this.
It can be for a number of reasons, but clearly inflationary pressure, supply chain challenges, has resulted in project delivery slipping. Probably add with regards to the NZ portfolio and the I think it's a £91.92 million in capital reduction there. We have provided project development support to undertake feasibility studies and business cases to secure investment in future years, as well as beginning to support a number of multi-year projects. And in addition to that, we have recently established a heat network support unit to work directly with pre-capital projects to support development ahead of capital investment. So this will provide greater certainty for spend in future years. So there's the economic context in which we're operating in, but we are taking action in here to help address that going forward.
I mean, the one I should say, roads and taxis capital project, £7.2 million. I can't believe for a second there's no demand for that money. I mean, I can tell you one project in my own constituency, it's been delayed 2 years because of governance procedures, you know, which still try to find out after 2 years what they are, actually, from Transport Scotland, who've been taking a fifth on it. I can't really understand why there was £7.2 million lack of demand in roads and capital projects.
There's areas where there's demand, but there's also areas where we've had to make purposeful savings to go and ensure that we balance the budget position in year. They are savings identified within the EBR, which will are either pressure reductions, some of which may come through as savings in the spring budget revision, but we don't have the degree of certainty at the moment to include that within ABR.
OK, well, thank you very much for those responses. I'm going to open out the session to colleagues around the table, and the first person to ask questions will be Ross, to be followed by Liz.
Thanks, Kinmere. Minister, I'd be interested in a bit of clarity around which of the budget revisions are presumed to be one-off, either for issues of underspend, unforeseen circumstances, etc., and which are areas where, for example, in the NZ portfolio, it notes that some of these are because of lower-than-expected demand. Which of those are lower-than-expected levels of demand that are now expected to reoccur, i.e. where the new figure after this budget revision will be baselined into next year's budget versus where we would expect to simply go back to a baseline of what was in the budget at the start of this year?
Okay, well, you'll appreciate we'll set our position for the next financial year at the budget. That will be determined by a number of factors, as you would appreciate. On net zero, our commitment is absolute in that area. That should be clear. But what we're having to do with this ABR is make sure, one, we arrive at a balanced budget position by the end of the financial year, as we're required to do, and two, seek to free up resource to provide support in year. So that has been part of the EBR exercise. Now, they are from the September statement that the Deputy First Minister made. Some of these savings are captured within ABR. There's £191 million of pressures identified which may fall through with SBR. With the EBR, it was statement and publication from earlier this month. Where appropriate and where required, that will come through SBR in terms of the savings identified. But as regards to future, to the next financial year and beyond, we're seeking to be consistent with the priority set out in the RSR. We will, of course, take the specific decisions at the budget.
Thanks very much. On the NZ reductions in particular, I recognise that this is not your portfolio, so you might not be able to go into some of the specifics at the moment. But given that some of these are some of the more substantial reductions, what expectation does government have on the effect of that on hitting our NZ targets around whether it's emission reduction, nature restoration, etc.? Or even separate to that, these affect the child poverty targets when it relates to home energy efficiency?
I think these are an important points. I don't want to repeat what I've already said, but the two points I made is one, in this area it ultimately reflects demand, but two, we are taking action in year to help support with project delivery, multi-year projects to help address that. So delivering on these particular ambitions and what these lines seek to deliver is vital for NZ. What we have to be doing, what we are doing, is ensuring that we are supporting the demand so that these funds are drawn down in future years to enable the outcomes that we seek to effect.
Thanks. And just finally from me, on this question of whether or not the savings reoccur, i.e. the baseline is the figure we've now got versus, rather than what we started the financial year with, where these savings were to deliver what was required for public sector pay, we can presume that that's obviously a recurring cost. Public sector pay increases were not one-off to this year, so we will need to find that money from somewhere in future years. It doesn't necessarily need to come from the specific areas it came from this year, but what instructions have been issued to ministers, to civil service directors around evaluating the impact of these savings and whether or not it would in fact be a sensible decision to baseline the new figure in from next year, because the potential negative consequences were manageable in some way?
I think what we will do is, as part of the budget process and setting the budget for next year, is of course consider what demand has been for demand-led schemes in the previous years. Demand-led schemes is always one of the challenges that we have in the budget, particularly as we get towards year end. It can be a challenge if there is less demand in forecast, because that gets towards the end of your position, how much money, what potential underspends are emerging. It can be obviously a challenge if demands are exceeding forecast. So we reflect on that as part of the budget setting process to take into consideration what the effective level should be for the following year. With regards to what's identified in the document, what these capital savings have allowed, the £120 million capital to local government to support pay deals, that of course is for this year and for next year, then it will be wound in as revenue going forward from then.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Liz. To be followed by John.
Thank you. Good morning. Can I just bring you back to a comment that the Convener was asking about regarding the transfer from capital to resource budgets? Because as far as I'm concerned, most of the time I've been in this Parliament, that's not really been possible, namely that there are rules that, or fiscal rules that really are directed at ensuring that that is not the transfer that takes place. Can I just ask Minister just to confirm that because of the extenuating circumstances that you set out, that that rule has now been eased or changed?
Is this specifically with Scottish government spend?
Yes, it is, because, as I say, the sort of discipline, the fiscal discipline, if you like, has really always been that capital budgets could be transferred to capital budgets, but not to resource budgets. It can go the other way, but generally speaking, it's not been a case that the capital budget money could be used for resource spending, and that seems to be what is happening just now. And I just would like you to confirm whether that easing of that fiscal discipline is for the extenuating circumstances that you outline, or whether you are looking to ease the rules on that.
The seeking to be able to reclassify capital to resource is something we have sought to engage with the UK government on because of these circumstances, but that is not something that we have yet had agreement from the UK government on.
And is that then part of the negotiations for the new fiscal framework that you're looking at?
This is specific to our in-year situation. As you'll appreciate at the Chancellor's autumn statement, there was no new in-year funding announced at that point. So we still face a significant challenge in managing the various pressures that we've already discussed. We still have, you know, a third of the financial year to run. So we are seeking that flexibility where we would be able to reclassify capital as resource to support the in-year position. I don't know if there's anything you want to add, Neil.
It was just in case the question was about the local government.
No, it's very much about... Right. Well, effectively it affects both, because obviously Scottish Government goes to local government funds as well. But the issue that I'm asking about is that if there is to be an easing of the fiscal discipline about the transfer of money between capital to resource budgets, is that something that reflects the current extenuating circumstances where you say you've been engaging with the UK government because of the difficulties that you face? Or do you presume that there could be a long-term change to that fiscal discipline where it would be possible on a longer-term basis to transfer from capital resources into from capital budgets into resources?
The ask reflects the current set of circumstances that we face. We have to operate within the decisions and processes set out by the UK government, by HMT. As for longer-term considerations through the fiscal framework, we would obviously want a situation where we had maximum flexibility across all aspects of our budget, but that will be something that will be subject to negotiation through the fiscal framework. But my specific references to seeking the ability to reclassify capital as resource is specific to this financial year and the circumstances that we find ourselves in.
OK. Can I just ask, from the perspective of the fiscal framework negotiations, do you have any updates on the timescales of when the independent report is due and at what stage the government's negotiations are with the UK government thereafter?
I don't have an update at this stage. As you'll appreciate, there has been a lot of flux with regards to the UK government. But when we're in a position to give an update, I'll be happy to show.
Do we have any update on the timing of the independent report, though?
I don't have that, but if there is an update to give, I'll be happy to write to the committee.
I think that'd be very helpful if we could have that. Minister, just on a slightly different theme, I mean, the Scottish Government in its programme for government sets out very distinctive three principles around which government policy is devised, and one of these is the move to net zero and justice within the green economy. Can I just ask you, if that is one of the defining principles, it seems a bit odd that there has been such a big downturn in the net zero budget, very substantial downturn, and just how that fits around the principles of the Scottish Government's programme for government, when that was very much one of the three identified principles, as to why that's happened. And secondly, if there are to be changes to the principles that surround government policy, if we could just perhaps know a little bit more about them, because on what basis are you... And I know you can't go through every single change, that would be unrealistic to ask that, but are there specific criteria around which you are examining government spending just now in relation to your budget spend?
I want to be absolutely clear. Net zero is a key priority of this government. It is a moral imperative in regards to the
broader programme for government. There's a range of actions we're taking forward. You know, clearly, in this specific case with the NZ, being able to decarbonise the energy, particularly how we heat our buildings, is going to be a key aspect of that. And as I set out earlier, we have initiated work to help support the pipeline of projects, to help address that under-demand that there has been for these funds. But it's important to recognise that within the broader context of work that is underway. For example, wearing another hat, a few weeks ago published our revised national planning framework, which has been warmly welcomed by the Scottish renewable sector, seen as a remarkable step forward. So I think it's just important to recognise the particular fiscal circumstances and economic circumstances we're in at the moment, but that does not detract from the imperative and the priority of meeting our net zero obligations.
Except the figures here would suggest otherwise, because it's such a big downturn. And, you know, it's quite difficult, I would have thought, to convince people that the Scottish Government's priorities, which include that very strong move to net zero, is being adhered to within this specific budget.
I think the allocation of that budget at the Scottish budget earlier this year demonstrates that commitment. But the issue here has been demand. It's not been one of a willingness of the government to supply the resource, but it has been the demand which has led to being in a position where we've been able to reallocate that funding to support the in-year position. But I recognise the point that you're making, and that is why we are taking the action that we are to help address issues whereby there has been a shortfall in demand, and that is why the work I outlined earlier to support project development is taking place.
OK, well, just one final point. Obviously, we've talked a lot as a committee about the National Performance Framework. How much of the decisions that you're taking in terms of the budget adheres to the principles of that National Performance Framework?
I think if we consider the measures that we're taking to support public sector pay, that has a number of outcomes which are consistent with the NPF and the SDGs, which the NPF reflects. Our support for measures to ensure that we meet our obligations in reducing child poverty, again, they're reflected in there. So whether that be on the expansion of provisions for free school meals, for holiday meal entitlement, the 47 million for the whole family fund, there's a range of activity that takes place that is consistent with that. We do find ourselves in a exceptionally challenging economic and fiscal set of circumstances, but in taking the decisions that we have taken, we have sought to be consistent with our values and principles as articulated within the National Performance Framework, and I think the ABR demonstrates a consistency with that approach.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Joined before by Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. Just initially to go back to the technical adjustments and the IFRS 16 adjustments. So I think I understand that operating leases didn't used to be on the balance sheet and now they will be on as both an asset and liability, so the net effect is nil. Does that have an impact on our borrowing limits, the $3 billion, because it doesn't? Would it in future? So there's just no effect. So that is effectively that issue is looked after by Westminster, by the Treasury, and it doesn't impact on us at all.
As it stands.
Right. Okay, well, that's nice and clear. That's fine. Good. Right. I'm happy to ask a simple question and get a simple answer. That's quite commendable, actually. In paragraph 45 of the guide, it talks about the emergency budget review, and it says, while the amounts outlined in the letter are savings based on the in-year budget monitoring position, these do not necessarily correspond to a budget being formally surrendered as part of the gross funding movement. And I was just struggling a bit with this phrase, budget being formally surrendered, and what that would mean. And then it goes on to say, this is because these savings may be against forecast pressures that are being transferred internally. And again, I'm not sure I understand what that means, forecast pressures that are being transferred internally.
Sorry, I wasn't sure if you'd finished your question, Mr. Mason.
I'll stop there.
I think one thing I would recognise is it's not entirely possible to look at the savings presented in the September and November ABR documentation and read across directly to the ABR. The savings highlighted, they include movements and pressures that are present within the in-year monitoring position. For example, demand-led budget expectations, but which have not had budget formally allocated to them. And so the attention of analysis that were provided in the guide was to highlight where the EBR documents can be read across and where there are differences. But the point I would come to is the one that I made earlier on, is some of these pressure reductions will manifest as savings and be identified through SBR, but there's just not the degree of certainty currently to present them in the ABR.
Right. So, I mean, some of them would have been savings that were made anyway, so the EBR effectively is not having an impact on that area if they were going to make the savings anyway.
Well, these are, you know, pressures. There's unfunded pressures that have emerged that were not present when the budget was passed. So part of the exercise is identifying and reducing. As I said earlier, there's two aims through the EBR process. Yes, one is to identify resources to provide additional support in the context of the cost of living crisis, but the other is to ensure that we achieve a balanced budget position at the close of financial year. But there will be, I appreciate this is a complex picture, but there will be elements of those savings identified which are not captured in the ABR, which will be captured in the SBR. Don't know if there's anything you want to add, Neil?
I think, so there is one table in the guide just a bit further down which breaks down the entire list of the 560 million items into three categories. So there's funding changes, there's items that were included as a saving in the EBR, in the autumn budget revision, and then there's the pressure reductions. And the best example there, when you talk about surrender of budget, the concessionary travel there, you can see that there's a 20.7 million that's included in the autumn budget revision. But there was a further pressure that was identified earlier that wasn't in the budget, but we now expect, obviously, as demand has fallen, for that to not crystallise either. So the total saving from our forecast position is the two added together, 37.6, but the budget that's surrendered is only 20.7.
Right, still toiling a wee bit, but anyway, we'll keep going. So that 20.7, if I'm looking at the same table, becomes, is part of a total of 223.9 at the bottom of that table, is that correct? And after that, it talks in paragraph 51 about a balance of 191.5 million. So what's the difference between these two columns, the 223.9 and the 191.5?
It's just with regards to what is identified within the ABR and what is identified as an unfunded pressure.
Okay, so that's the difference. So some of it is in the total is part of the emergency budget review, but some of it, the 223.9, is in this autumn budget review, is that right?
Yeah.
And so the 191.5, we're basically so unsure about, we can't put it in at the moment.
It's, as I say, it's pressure reductions. Some of that may materialise as savings through the SBR.
Okay, well, I mean, maybe other colleagues want to come in as well. But
I suppose the best way of saying it is, if it wasn't in the budget in the first place, you don't need to change it.
To do anything, right, okay.
But it was in our forecast position in an earlier stage in the year. But there are, the point we're trying to make in the guide was that there are some components within that column of 191 which might have an impact at the spring budget revision. But if all of those pressures were in our forecast position, so from our budget management, it is a saving.
Right. Okay, so there's a degree of uncertainty around that column, and it could be perhaps a department which is, looks like it's overspending actually manages to catch up over the next few months, so that would be good news, I guess. Right. Because it then goes on in paragraph 53 to say the EBR process identified approximately £615 million of additional options for spending reductions. So these are not definite. That suggests there's a degree of uncertainty around that figure.
Well, this is paragraph 53, this is the 615, well,
yes.
As it sets out below, there's clear lines there, there was £400 million which stays within health and social care, and that was to support the fair pay offer. There is the £33 million of resource saving, and there is the £180 million of capital and FT reductions to support the wider financial position. So again, some of that may be ultimately reflected in SBR where required.
Okay.
But there's not, there's only a very small amount that's reflected in ABR.
Right. And I think the final area I just wanted to ask about was the whole question of the spillover. And I know that's been a debate that's been going on for quite some time, the spillover dispute with the UK government. Mm-hmm. And I think we've got a figure of £375 million now. Is that what Scottish Government was expecting, or is that more or less?
There had been anticipation of £400,375,000, but this year no one has been decided and engaged through the fiscal framework review, is there?
Yeah, so there was a rough assumption in the budget. I think you might remember there was £620 million total other income, and within that we had a rough estimate internally of £400 million. But that was if on the basis that the dispute would conclude for the end up to and including the end of 22-23. I think the basis of the calculation was it would go to the end of 21-22 with the current year and future years as part of the fiscal framework review. So that's why the figure was £375 million.
Okay. So that was a good estimate, so that's good. So looking then at the current year, 22-23, and this £25 million or whatever it might be, I mean, given what I think Liz Smith has already asked about, we're a bit uncertain about the timing of the framework review. I'm a bit concerned that is involving the current year's budget, because that causes you, presumably, Minister, quite a lot of uncertainty as to what you can do this year when that figure is uncertain. I don't know if there's other figures elsewhere that are going to be kind of backdated to the 1st of April, depending on when the spending review, and we might not even know that till next year?
There's much in terms of engagement with the UK government that causes uncertainty around our public finances, Mr. Mason, I'm sure you'll appreciate. What we draw your attention to is paragraph 71, and to recognise it, which this paragraph states, it's a complex picture, but the other income funding assumptions have been met and have been surpassed by £324 million when the borrowing cost adjustment is reflected in full. So I hope that provides some more clarity.
I'm not sure it does, actually. I wasn't going to ask you about that paragraph, but now you've raised it. So is the 25, can we say that's kind of small enough in the scale of things that we just kind of cope with that because we're looking at other figures? I don't know if the 25 is in the 324 or if the 324 is different.
It was just with regards to what our position is from what we had anticipated with regards to other income as identified in the budget document as published last December and what our position is as now.
Right, so you made a kind of estimate, I remember, of a different things, including this, and actually it's turning out better. So this year, we don't need to worry too much about when the fiscal framework review concludes, because we're basically okay for this year. Would that be fair?
We are, of course.
I mean, I know we've got problems this year, but I mean, we're not depending on the fiscal review to fix this year's budget.
We're not depending upon the fiscal framework review to fix this year's budget, but I'm not going to suggest in any way that this is not an issue that does need to be addressed, through the fiscal framework.
Okay, that's a good answer, clear answer. Right, thanks, convener.
Thank you, John. And Liz wanted to come in with a supplementary.
Just a very minor point of clarification, just in answer to Mr Mason's first point when he was talking about the difference between the two columns, that when you said that, I think I heard you correctly, that when it came to that second figure, that was money that you thought might have to be used for the 195, I think it was.
191. This is from our internal monitoring, the budget pressures. Is this the column pressure reductions?
Yes. So on what sort of criteria was that based? What did you use to make that particular estimate?
Well, there's a number of things that sort of lead to previously unfunded pressures that were discussed already. But maybe just ask Neil to come in and read a bit more.
Yeah, I mean, it's just how you came about 191 rather than anything else.
Well, that was just looking across all lines. Essentially, the 191 wasn't a target figure in of itself. The 560 was the figure that was included in the letter that the committee received from Deputy First Minister on the 7th. This is just itemising it into how we look at it from budget monitoring. So you've got the items that are included in the autumn budget revision, and there's 191 items which are not in the autumn budget revision, but they were in our budget monitoring forecasts. And because steps have been taken or demand has reduced, they are effectively a savings.
So demand forecasts. For the money has reduced?
Well, in the case of the concessionary travel, demand has reduced, therefore the pressure on that budget has also reduced.
I think, Convener, it would be quite helpful with a little bit more detail about some of these things.
What specific detail would you like, Liz?
I'd just like to know, for example, you've just given a good example of how, from the transport budget, there's been specific changes that you had potentially thought were going to be included and didn't have to be. It would be helpful to know what the other ones were.
Okay. I would say maybe Mr Caldwell can provide those just now.
Well, they're all listed here.
Well, which?
So there's a table.
Where are they exactly? Because I could.
It's a table just after paragraph 50, which details them all out.
It goes through line by portfolio.
Right, and that comes out as a total of 191 that you thought might have to be used but hasn't been. Okay. I mean, I see the mathematical or arithmetical calculations. I'm just interested as to the nature of why some of these figures are what they are. But we'll leave that just now. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Douglas?
Yeah, thanks. I mean, I'm confused by this figures as well, and I'm going to ask one more question around it.
Yeah.
So if we look at employability, for example, it's 53 million of a pressure reduction. So did that 53 million, where did it appear at the start of the year? Where was that money? Where was it budgeted?
Sorry, what line are you referring to?
I'm looking at employability. It's about halfway down under finance and economy, 53 million. Because that's one of the big ones. That's the biggest one.
So, well, this would have been. I can't speak to each individual line. I don't know if there's any more
details. Just as an example, be the minister. That's why I was picking that one. So was it in the employability budget at the start of the year?
No.
Or was it? No, it wasn't.
As I say, these are pressures that emerge through our monitoring, internal monitoring, and that is what we have sought to reduce these forecast pressures.
So where was that 53 million at the start of the year? Was there a biscuit tin of 191 million that's now been raided? I'm struggling to understand where, because it seems to be a saving from an amount that wasn't actually allocated in the first place.
Well, the savings that are specifically identified, which have been reallocated, they have been included in the ABR. There may be savings that emerge, that what were currently identified as pressure reductions may translate into savings which would emerge at SBR.
But where was that pressure going to be funded from in the first place?
So, I think maybe if you think the Scottish budget is laid in December, mm-hmm. Then when we're doing the forecasts of what the financial position and all the pressures and potential savings and changes in demand might be, the forecast picture can look quite different from the budget, so we have to manage that position in year. And these pressure reductions are where forecasts have changed from when the budget was laid in December. And that's one of the bigger ones that you identify there.
So was there a contingency of 191 that were eaten into then? Is that?
There's no specific contingency pot of 191 million.
Mm-hmm. We set the budget at the start of the year, but circumstances can change and pressures can emerge. So that's on the our spend side, and it equally, it's, I suppose the flip of that is the uncertainty we always face and how much money we're going to have available, because we don't get into a settled position on our what we receive from the UK government until very much close towards the end of the financial year through the supplementary estimates process. So there's always uncertainty, so I appreciate it can look like when we pass a budget in Parliament at that certain, but there's always pressures that can emerge due to changes of circumstances, particularly with demand-led schemes. And there is also, as well, we don't have certainty around our funding position that we receive from the UK government until much closer towards
so,
the end.
So, Minister, was it assumed there was going to be extra funding coming through, you know, that would fund this 191 million, but then that hasn't maybe come through, so then that 191 has got to be
what this is this
back
is
down again.
Yeah, this is the emergence of pressures that have developed in year, and as such, the work has been taken to reduce these pressures.
Yeah, but it's where I'm struggling to work out where that 191 was at the start of the year.
There wasn't 191 million at the start of the year to fund these pressures. So steps had to be taken, or where there was demand reduced, and these could be brought down. It's not there's no direct line that 53 or the 191 is coming from.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll move on. But I'm going back to the capital again, for obviously you're looking to have more flexibility from the UK government around the capital and converting it into revenue. I think that was how I understood it. So, and I think you were about to mention local government when you were answering a previous question. Will you give local government the same flexibility if you get that flexibility from the UK government?
Well, with regards to the flexibility towards local government, that does actually form part of the process of supporting public pay. So, as you'll be aware, there was a 120 million of capital funding provided to local government to fund capital expenditure, and it is ultimately to be deployed at council's discretion. Now, the capital grant accounting flexibilities reflected in the statutory guidance permit local authorities to replace existing revenue reserves, which they have allocated to capital investment, with the capital grant. This is in the context of supporting public sector pay. So the new capital grant will fund the planned capital expenditure that would have been met from earmarked revenue reserves, enabling the release of those revenue reserves to meet the pay award. Statutory guidance is required to address a restriction that requires a transfer of capital grant to a specific statutory reserve within local authority accounts. The relaxation of this restriction widens the permitted use of the grant to meet the principal element of loan repayments, which are capital in nature. So this was with regards to the £120 million capital that was confirmed for local government. I think that was in the letter to the committee of the 7th of September. And that is through... that is how that capital there is being used to support local government pay offers.
So it's almost like using, they would have to, local authorities would have to use the reserves, and then the capital grant could then be converted to top up the reserves again in a strange sort of way.
Well, the point was made about revenue can be used to pay for capital, revenue reserves meeting capital expenditure. If you capital can then be used to meet that capital, freeing up the revenue reserve, which can then meet.
And would that flexibility just be for pay, or I'm thinking things like, you know, obviously cost of meals have increased, so would there be that flexibility as well to convert capital into revenue to support those sort of areas?
Well, this is specific to the support provided for local government pay.
So nothing else then?
Is there anything you want to?
So I think it's my understanding that it's agreed for this year.
Right.
But we can double check.
Okay. Move on to the next question I had. Paragraph 19 had additional funding for £7 million for the funicular railway on the Cairngorms, and an extra £6.7 million to Ferguson Marine for the A201 and A202. Are those sums already been announced, or is this an addition to anything that was put aside for those two projects previously?
This is ABR's retrospective in nature, so it's just confirming.
It's just confirming. So this is announced figures already, so it hasn't increased those projects by those amounts?
It's consistent with previous announcements.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. Next question I had was on the R100. Obviously, there has been some funding changes around that. £16 million, I think it was, in terms of capital. What impact is that going to have on the R100 project going forward? Is that going to delay that project further?
The project, the timescales were rephased following issues emerging through the pandemic, which impacted upon timing. And so the capital that you refer to just reflects that longer time scale.
So how far is it going to push that out then?
I don't have the exact time scale in front of me, but in terms of that's the reason why the capital has become available.
Okay. Next question I had was on paragraph 26, rural Hamlets, £9.5 million of savings from the agriculture and rural economy. Do you have any idea what impact that's going to have on our rural population? What's it for specifically?
Was this the Scottish Rural Development Programme?
It's paragraph 26, Minister.
As it states in the guidance, it's just a combination of revised forecasts and modifications within the Scottish Rural Development Programme.
So we don't know what specifically that would have been used for and the impact that's going to have? Or...
Well, so it's revised forecasts specifically within that line.
Okay. So there's nothing specific that it's going to affect or that you're aware of?
In terms of what the specific implications will be and how that decision's been arrived at, I can't provide you with that information directly. If it's something you would like me to follow up on, I'd be happy to do so.
That would be good, yeah. And last question I had was around 28, Whitehall transfer of £6.5 million from the Money Advice Service. Can you give me a bit more detail on that, please?
Yeah, it's the debt advice levy. It's in the social justice line, so it's money advocated for that.
Will it actually be used for money advice services?
Yeah, that's in. It's identified within the support document.
Great, thank you. I guess, and I just want to go back on one last point, and that was on the energy grants again. Obviously, you've said it was a key priority and a commitment. So how can we ensure that the take-up is better in future years? Because it's great having announced a big pot of cash, but we're often critical of the UK government for trying to get the benefits uptake greater. So what are you doing to get that uptake greater so we're not having an underspend of almost £92 million?
It's a fair question. I've just touched the points I made earlier, which is that we have provided project development support to undertake feasibility studies and business cases to secure investment in future years. And as I say, we've begun to support a number of multi-year projects. In addition to that, we've recently established a HATE network support unit to work directly with pre-capital projects to support development ahead of capital investment. So the intention is that this will provide greater certainty for future years.
But do you think private sector and the local authority partners are well aware of what's available?
Well, certainly that's what we've endeavoured to achieve, but clearly I've already outlined the action that we're taking, but we would obviously want to see these budgets deployed fully and fully utilised. We have an important role to play in delivering on our net zero obligations. So there's always a process of learning to ensure that we maximise awareness and maximise uptake. But it's also important to recognise that beyond making money available in government efforts to increase awareness and uptake, prevailing economic conditions can and do have an impact, whether that be inflationary pressures, supply chains, skill shortages, which all governments are wrestling with. But I would just want to assure the committee that we are absolutely determined and focused to ensure that we meet our net zero obligations. And I'm happy to reflect upon the points that the members raised.
So what's this going to do to your targets then? Is this going to delay your targets, or are you looking to increase investment in future years? What's it going to do?
We have absolutely committed to our target net zero by 2045. And as I touched on earlier, notwithstanding the work that we will do to ensure greater uptake of funding that's available in future years, which I've already outlined, it's important to recognise where this sits within the broader work that government undertakes across a range of areas to support us reaching these targets.
Mm-hmm. I'm struggling to understand how we can reach these targets if we're such a huge underspend unless we increase the spending going forwards. But as you said, if there's there's budgetary pressures in future years, then will that be pushed back again?
Clear priority and focus of this government, a clear priority and focus of this government is net zero, and the funding and that will be matched, and that commitment will be met in action through funding and through other areas as well across government. We find ourselves in a situation this year where there has been lower than forecast demand. I've set out the action that the government is undertaking to support greater uptake of these funds in future years. And clearly there will be a process of continued learning around how we ensure that these funds are utilised to the fullest extent. But I would just also note that we are facing an exceptionally challenging set of economic circumstances, which of course impact upon public finances, but they will impact upon decisions of individual households and businesses as well.
But would you accept a criticism if this was your key priority, number one commitment, that you would do everything you could to make sure that money was spent to make sure you'd meet your targets going forward?
I think what we would want to recognise is that we would want that resource to be deployed in the most effectful and impactful way, but it is ultimately a demand-led scheme. So the kind of key issue that has been addressed is the shortfall in demand, which I accept and recognise there has been, and that's why I've set out the action that the government's taken to address that shortfall in demand. And of course, I'm sure this is something Parliament and indeed the lead committee on NZET will take a keen interest in, because it's clearly in all our interests to ensure that when resource is made available to support the transition to net zero, that it is fully utilised. And so that is something we can learn from the experience of this year, which we are doing through the action that we're taking to support greater uptake.
Okay, thanks, Minister. Thanks, Kimina.
Okay, thank you very much. Your final question did take about 10 more questions, but never mind. Just one more area for me, and that can, of course, mean any number if we follow Douglas's example. But you've said, Minister, about the importance of raising awareness and uptake in some of these demand-led schemes. Now, employability, my understanding was that the budget initially was £82 million for the year and has been reduced by £53 million to £29 million. That's an almost two-thirds reduction. So one has to ask if the forecasting in terms of the demand, it seems to me to be wildly inaccurate. You can correct me if these figures are wrong, but since the pandemic, the number of people who are economically inactive in the United Kingdom has grown by 600,000, and obviously a fair share of those are in Scotland. So it does seem an odd time to reduce employability. And I would have thought that programmes at the time of the budget were decided would be planned long in advance, because these would be, important programmes to take forward if we are going to ensure that the number of people that are economically inactive reduces and they become more productive members of society. Because obviously productivity and economic output and growth is stagnating, as we all know.
I think you highlighted there was the figure for the United Kingdom as a whole. It speaks to the scale of the issue that you raise, and also the fact that it's not a Scottish-specific phenomenon, and that it is perhaps not something that is directly related to the availability of support. Clearly, that people will have potentially, in the consequence of the pandemic, had reflected on that experience, made different decisions around different life choices, for example. The issue around inactivity is something that, of course, all governments are engaged on. But I think it's sort of touched on in terms of what we're focused on throughout the emergency budget review process and through the ABR process, which reflects some of that, is ensuring that we are providing support directly in the here and now to those most need it, those who most need it, within the context of a challenging fiscal set of circumstances, and also the limitations of the fiscal framework in which we operate. The other point I would broadly note, when you recognise yourself, is that notwithstanding the level of economic inactivity, we have still been experiencing an incredibly tight labour market. I recognise some early evidence that suggests that's changing. But one of the challenges that we have had is obviously been the labour shortages across a whole range of sectors. That is again part of the sort of, you know, the broader circumstances in which we find ourselves.
Yeah, but we still have 100,000 or so people unemployed, even if you account for the people, even if you don't account for the people who are economically inactive, which in some areas are over 30% of the population, such as my own. So it does seem a bit odd that employability, which is designed to try and get more people back into work, you know, seems to have been reduced. But the point I was making in terms of this autumn budget revision is that it looks like you have wildly overestimated, if what you say is true in terms of demand, the demand for this by, you know, some 200%. If £29 million is going to be sufficient to actually address these issues, why was £82 million forecast? It does seem a huge, you know, difference. If it was £30 million, £33 million, £35 million, £40 million, I can understand it, but it does seem an awful lot of a... It just seems such a huge difference. I mean, in previous years, what was the kind of amount that was being spent on employability? Because one would think, you know, there'd be a fairly level amount spent on that. So it does seem quite odd that this budget seems wildly out of kilter with what it was estimated to be initially.
Yeah, I think I'd also recognise the interest that was taken in this particular line. I think it would have been back on the 7th of September when the September EBR statement was made. There's a number of factors that obviously at play. One, in terms of what demand has been, but also going back to those two key principles which underpin the whole EBR exercise, much of which is reflected within the ABR, which is to ensure that we are balancing our budget in year, and where possible, redirecting support to respond to the immediate cost crisis that individuals and households face. And that has, of course, necessitated taking decisions about how we should reprioritise certain budget lines, and that's something that has been reflected through the EBR and, indeed, through the ABR itself.
OK, I won't press it any further. All I'll do now is thank you for the responses to the questions that yourself and your officials have given to us today. And we now turn to agenda item 2, which involves formal consideration of the motion on the instrument before us. So I invite the Minister to speak to and move S6M06548. The Finance and Public Administration Committee recommends that the Budget Scotland Act 2022 Amendment Regulations 2023 draft be approved. Do members have any further comments? No. I now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M06548 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Sorry.
Moved.
Apologies. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Okay, so thank you very much to Mr Arthur and his officials for their evidence today. We'll publish a short report to Parliament setting out a decision on the regulations in due course. Thank you very much. And we'll now go into private session. As the Deputy First Minister is unable to arrive before 11:30, I'm going to go into private session in order that we can go through item 4 so that we're not... it's a more efficient use of committee time. Now turn to the third item on our agenda, which is to take evidence on the Scottish Government's Continuous Improvement Programme and its updated complaints policy. Members have also received a letter containing additional information from the Deputy First Minister on Friday to inform today's discussion. The letter and our meeting papers are also available on the committee's website. Today we will take evidence from John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery. Mr Swinney is supported today by Scottish Government officials Ian Mitchell and Ashley Gray. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite Mr Swinney to make a short opening statement. Good morning, Mr Swinney.
Good morning, Convener. I'm grateful for the opportunity to give evidence to the committee again on the progress of the procedure for handling complaints by civil servants about a current or former minister's behaviour and the continuous improvement programme to promote the culture and behaviours we want to see in the Scottish Government. When I last appeared before the committee on the subject in April, the procedure had been operational from the 24th of February, following a period of wide engagement with Scottish Government staff, trade unions and this committee. The procedure is founded on a grievance process that has to balance employment law and public law, and that is consistent with ACAS codes and guidance. Since it is a grievance procedure for staff, the procedure rightly emphasises the need for privacy and confidentiality, with outcomes restricted to only those closely involved. As the First Minister set out in Parliament, and as I have said in correspondence to the committee, given the legitimate public interest issues at play, it is appropriate for us to balance the expectations of confidentiality with the public role of a minister if a complaint is made about them. We have been working to make proposals to change the procedure and the Scottish Ministerial Code to allow for greater transparency in relation to the reporting of the subject of a complaint. I see this as a natural development of the procedure. Having trust and confidence in the process is fundamental for those who feel they have a legitimate complaint to come forward. It is important for me to set out that the public disclosure of the outcome would not affect the confidentiality of the process with respect to the complainer or others involved in the case, such as witnesses. I cannot stress this point strongly enough. In relation to the confidence of ministers, they should be assured that the process will be fair and that expectations are set out and clearly communicated. After careful consideration, we propose to update the procedure and the Scottish Ministerial Code to reflect that after the conclusion of the investigation, including any appeal, the name of the minister who is the subject of the complaint is to be publicly disclosed, as well as the outcome of the complaint. In addition, a redacted decision report for upheld or partially upheld cases will be published. For complaints that are not upheld, this is a different scenario, and it is proposed that more limited reporting is fair. As such, the minister's name and the outcome will be published for a period of 6 months. Changes will not be made retrospectively to investigations that have already been completed. Under the changes that I'm discussing with the committee today, publication of the outcomes of future complaints about former ministers will be reported in the same way as complaints about current ministers. We will also proactively report the number of cases currently under investigation and any concluded in the previous period on a 6-monthly basis. This will be reported on the Scottish Government website. These proposals mean that ministers past and present will work to a more transparent set of reporting principles for upholding standards of behaviour in public life. We will publish these figures for the first time in December, after a short period of reflection on these changes with the committee, with staff, ministers and with trade unions. We've worked in tandem with our trade unions and staff and have taken soundings and advice from others with experience in complaints handling. Should there be complaints in the future, I believe that in publicly reporting the information I'm setting out today, we are striking the right balance between the public interest and maintaining the privacy and confidentiality of the complainant. I look forward to discussing these updates with the committee. In addition to the updates to the procedure, I'm pleased to say that the Continuous Improvement Programme has successfully completed the activities scheduled for the end of each quarter. A programme update was submitted to the committee at the end of July, and another will be completed to reflect the activities scheduled for the end of December. The programme has made good progress. The measures of success have been identified from the Scottish Government People Survey and will be supplemented by engagement that the Propriety and Ethics Directorate has started throughout the organisation. The measures attempt to assess the degree to which the Continuous Improvement Programme has contributed to an improved culture of openness and inclusion in the workplace. This is a workplace where bullying and harassment is not tolerated, and where early intervention and mediation continue to have a key role in addressing the majority of issues that arise before they become problematic. However, it is also a workplace where, if needed, our staff feel able and willing to speak out against unacceptable behaviours and understand and have confidence in the processes that are in place. I look forward to discussing the programme with the committee today.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm just going to touch initially on the comments that you made in this opening statement. So you said in that opening statement that there's a need for privacy and confidentiality and that the process has to be fair to both ministers and complainants, and it's important to strike the right balance. And I think, you know, to a large extent, that certainly seems to be the case with regard to ministers where a minister is found against. But I have to say, I'm really quite astonished that if complaints are not upheld, the minister will still be named, and the information will be published for a fixed period of 6 months, which of course is nonsense because it's been social media forever. You know, I mean, how is that actually fair to someone? If you make a complaint about someone which is not upheld, why should the person be named? I mean, the complainant's not going to be named. How is that fair to both sides if the minister is named for what is effectively something which they have not actually done? I mean, how is that natural justice?
There is a very, very difficult judgment here, convener, and in coming to that judgment, I would assure the committee it's an issue I have wrestled with very significantly because I understand exactly the points that you are raising. But as I've set out in my opening statement, there is a careful balance to be struck here between the nature of a due process to be undertaken and the need for there to be transparency about the way in which these issues are being handled. And you will note, convener, in the information I've shared with the committee, that there is a difference between the approach that will be taken should a complaint be upheld or partially upheld and a complaint not being upheld, in the sense that there would be no details shared about the substance of the complaint if the complaint was not upheld. But I recognise it is a careful balance. As I indicated, we are setting out these proposals to the committee. They're the subject of dialogue with our trade unions and with our staff. If the committee is minded to give me feedback on that question or on other questions, I will of course consider that feedback before we come to final decisions about the application of this in terms of changes to the procedure and the ministerial code.
I mean, I could have understood this perhaps 20 years ago, but now we live in a kind of fetid kind of environment on social media whereby the fact that a minister has just been named means that he or she will still be vilified. I mean, there'll still be no smoke without fire, all that kind of stuff. Is it fair to them, to a minister and his or her family, therefore, for that? I mean, the complainant's not going to be named anyway, so they're able to, you know, still continue on with their work, etc., even though they've made a complaint which has not been upheld. But the minister will still be, there'll still be that murk around the minister, will it not? Will it not? I cannot possibly, in my view, be fair. That's not a balance, I think. It just seems to me, and that's assuming that the privacy is respected throughout the process, which I would be shocked if it was, because leaks do happen in such instances.
I think the key thing, convener, is wrestling with the question of transparency, because I regularly hear the pressure for the government to be transparent about absolutely everything. And obviously we have statutory and legislative provisions in place that require us to act in such a fashion. And the judgment that I have come to in relation to this matter is that should there be, given that we will be reporting about the fact that we will have had a certain number of complaints, to ensure that we provide an entirely transparent picture, this is the right balance to strike. But as I indicated in my earlier answer, if the committee considers, you know, this is a matter of dialogue and scrutiny, you know, the government is trying to respond to the legitimate calls for transparency. If the committee, in its judgment, believes that that is a step too far, then, of course, I will listen to that feedback.
OK, that's fine. That's a very fair comment. Who will actually publish the report at the end of the 6 months, every 6 months?
The government will do so.
OK, well, will it be any, who specifically within the government?
It will be handled by the Propriety and Ethics Directorate within the Scottish Government, which has been established in recent years. It was established in the autumn of 2021 to ensure that we had in place all of the proper procedures and processes that members of the public would have a reasonable expectation that the government would make for the handling of such matters.
Now, obviously, if such matters are going to be published, I think it's important that the public know what the parameter is. So, how does the Scottish Government currently define bullying? I mean, is it subjective, or is it objective, as it should be?
I think it would be an objective assessment, and we're obviously putting in place, in these circumstances, a set of arrangements to try to address any such experiences. So that all goes, the whole approach goes back to part of what I said in my introductory remarks, that we aim to create a working environment in which there is no place for bullying, and we will set out in that advice and guidance what will be considered to be examples of bullying, because we can't be precise about absolutely everything, but all organisations are able to set out their reasonable expectations of what bullying might look like. So there are proactive efforts to create a climate and a culture which means that such behaviour is not in any way present in the working experience of members of staff. Should there be concerns raised, then obviously there is, again, in what I said earlier on, there is a keenness to ensure that those issues are resolved as early as possible, as proactively as possible. But then ultimately, if members of staff feel they have the basis upon which they wish to make a complaint, if they feel the issues have not been satisfactorily resolved, then they can do so, and we have a procedure which enables that to be addressed.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important to have objective criteria, and you're absolutely right, you can't encompass everything, but I do think it's important to have that, because the public's view of bullying may not be the same as the Scottish Government's. I mean, for example, particularly depending on how old you are, I mean, in my younger days, bullying was only about violence and intimidation, and now, of course, it's changed quite considerably in terms of how its perception. It's got a much more broader meaning, because I think now there's a much greater understanding of how psychological bullying can be just as well, of course, someone threatens you with violence, intimidation, that is obviously psychological as well, but there are other forms of bullying, psychological, for example, passive aggression, which is an issue, of course, that may or may not be covered by this. I'd be interested in finding out what that is. But if you could give us some examples of some of these objective criteria, I would appreciate that. So the public have a greater understanding of what you mean by... So if it's upheld, you can say, bullying was upheld because of the minister's actions in terms of X, Y, Z.
I think the best way to answer that, Kavita, is by reference to the standards of behaviour which we set out within the guidance to members of staff and to ministers. So that guidance will be set out in the ministerial code, it will be set out in the standards of behaviour that are expected for the undertaking of Scottish Government business. So I'm very happy to make those available to the committee to cast their eye over, because I think in those approaches give a very clear distillation of our expectations of what the workforce will be like, what the experiences of members of staff should be like, and if they are not of that order, then obviously they can be, you know, the conduct can be resolved through the various means that I've set out.
No one on this committee has been a minister, but I can imagine it can be quite a stressful and wearying job at times. So in terms of this entire scenario, will ministers be allowed to occasionally display the normal human traits of annoyance, frustration and impatience without potentially being denounced?
I think there is a careful balance to be struck between legitimate expectations of performance and support and inappropriate conduct. And that's you know, it's a point I am mindful of a great deal. There will be times where, you know, I'm frustrated by things that are put in front of me, but I will always express my frustration in an appropriate and courteous fashion. I need to be supplied with accurate information. If I don't use accurate information, then people complain about that. And if I don't think I'm getting accurate information, I will, you know, press to get that accurate information. But I'll do so in an appropriate fashion. There is that careful balance between setting out legitimate expectations of performance and behaving in a fashion where your conduct is not acceptable. And I think ministers have got to be very careful to calibrate that to balance in the right fashion.
OK, thank you very much for that. There's a number of colleagues who want to come in. So first will be Douglas, to be followed by Liz.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Mr Swinney, I was just going to ask about complaints that are maybe in progress already. So how will they be dealt with? Will they follow this new process or will they continue to work the old process? I'm just trying to think what will be shown in the report in December. Will there be anything at all?
There'll be nothing shown in the report in December as things currently stand today. So there's no complaints with the government. So we'd have none to report on in December.
Is that because there's none in progress or none in progress that would...
There's none that we have.
Right.
Full
okay.
Stop. And essentially the points, you know, we've got a complaints handling process which has been in place since February, and that is the process as it stands today. The changes that I'm explaining to the committee would so just for absolute total completeness, the procedure that was put in place in February, we have no complaints submitted under that basis. The changes I'm raising here today will give rise potentially to a moment of further change to the procedure in due course. Mm-hmm. At that moment, the points that I'm raising today will be included in the procedure. So any complaints received after that moment of application, notwithstanding my response to the convener's points that I'm, you know, the committee thinks we're not getting this right, I will be interested to hear that from the committee. We will reflect those changes in the procedures at that time.
Yeah, I think I slightly disagree with the convener. I think even if somebody's cleared, I think it should be published, just like we're having, you know, the standards commission on councillors just now. There's always the findings are always published. And in terms of previous complaints, I think there was a suggestion that you couldn't publish the findings or even to say whether it was the complaint was upheld or not without getting into the details of things. Was that correct? And
yes.
If it was, what was the legality around that stopped the government publishing the outcome of a...
Well, essentially, we have to have procedural arrangements in place that would enable that to be the case, and those arrangements didn't exist until the points that I'm putting to the committee this morning.
And that's because it didn't explicitly say that you would report on the outcome of a case, is that correct?
That's correct, yes.
Uh-huh. And you can't even report on the number of cases you've had, and whether, you know, how many were upheld, how many of them rejected, just to try and understand, you know, whether there's an issue here or not.
In relation to the detail of previous issues, we responded to two FOI requests in June 2022, confirming that two investigations had been carried out in respect of three complaints since 2007. And our judgment was that that was the information that was appropriate for us to disclose, given the fact that we have, given the points that I've said to Mr. Lumsden already.
Mm-hmm. And you don't think it's appropriate to share the information about whether a complaint was upheld or not?
We it's not that, it's that I judge it not to be appropriate, it's that we don't have a basis for so doing.
Right. Okay. Thanks, Convener.
Liz?
Thank you. Mr. Swinney, I do think that the Scottish Government and the Ethics Commission, or not Commission, but the Committee, has gone a long way to improving the transparency, and I very much welcome the progress that you have made since you first came to this Committee and now, particularly in relation to complaints that are upheld or partially upheld. I think that's very good news. I do have slight concerns, partly from what the convener said about those circumstances where the case has not been upheld, in ensuring that all that information comes out to the public, unless there is categorical assurance to the person who potentially could have been vilified through social media, as the convener mentioned, or otherwise, unless it is very clear what exactly the reasons are for not upholding this complaint. Because we all know, especially if there's a bit of a time delay between the complaint being made and the investigation process, there is scope for some individuals in any political party to be vilified by members of the public unfairly. And I'm just slightly concerned that that potentially could have a bit of an implication for those who are attracted into politics and, you know, who feel that the system is going to name and shame them, even when they've actually not done anything wrong. I'm a bit concerned about that process. So if I could just have your reflections on that. And the second thing, can I just ask, when you mentioned that, that obviously former ministers could be included in this, I take it that's all former ministers, there's no time bar of, you know, ministers who've not been in office for 10 years or whatever. This is all ministers, is it?
On that last point, yes, so all former ministers. In relation to the point about cases where a complaint is not upheld, I think the first point, just for me to be absolutely clear about this, we would not be publishing any details about the case other than the fact that the name of the minister and the fact that a complaint had not been upheld. Now, I'm not going to say to the committee that I think this is an absolutely certain judgment. You know, I've hope I've left enough scope for the committee to be able to consider this point. And indeed, you know, Mr. Lumsden has presented a different argument in his question to me to the one that Convener and Liz Smith potentially presents to me. So I understand the arguments that are made. I've wrestled with these very questions, and I came down on the side of the preference for transparency, of absolute transparency, but I do accept there is another and an alternative argument that could be applied in these circumstances, and I will, of course, consider it should the committee make that point to me.
It's just that if somebody very genuinely has not engaged in the activities of which they've been accused, I think it's quite good for the public to know why it was a wrong accusation. It helps that person, I think, to move on, rather than just to be named that there was a complaint made against them, but it wasn't upheld. I think that leaves just a little bit of doubt in the minds of that person.
I think the point that, you know, if for example, I accept, and I don't think there's any issue with this, indeed this has been part of the demand that has been made for us in terms of transparency, has been for any complaints received to be acknowledged that there have been complaints. Indeed, that the point lies at the heart of Mr. Lumsden's question to me. So if we take a scenario where we receive a complaint and it is not upheld, we would disclose a complaint has been received. Mm-hmm. If we were to say it has not been upheld, but it's not clear who the complaint was against, then there is a question mark across all current and serving ministers in that process. Sorry, current and previous ministers in that process. So there's a very careful balance to be calibrated here about what information should be available in such circumstances. I don't think there's any dispute about the fact that if there's a complaint that's been made and it's been upheld, that a certain amount of detail should be disclosed, but with protection of the names of complainants and witnesses. But I think the committee is alighting on an issue in which there is not an absolutely certain question. To go back to one other point that Liz Smith raised, which I didn't respond to in my earlier answer, is in relation to, you know, what does it all say to people who might think about becoming involved in politics? And of course, you know, we are all very familiar with the degree of public commentary that can go with the work that all of us are involved in. So it adds to that mix.
No, I just make the point that I completely understand what you're saying in relation to making available information that a complaint has been raised and there's the name of the person. If I was that person, I would just like the public to know that, you know, that this was turned down on these specific reasons, so that, you know, it sort of cleared my name. I wouldn't want it to be a scenario where there's ongoing doubt and confusion. I completely understand why you say that if you didn't name the person, then all ministers potentially are involved in the speculation. But if you are cleared of any wrongdoing, then I think it's important to make it clear why.
Deputy First Minister, do you not feel that the phrase "not upheld" sounds more like "not proven" than "not guilty"?
Well, I think I don't think it sounds like "not proven." No, I don't. You know,
I'm thinking about the public perception and the media perception.
We're in different language here, Convener. Has the complaint been upheld? Yes or no? Has the complaint been upheld? Yes or no? It's, you know, so if it's not been upheld, it's not got validity. It's not upheld.
Okay, Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. I just wanted to come back in on something, Mr. Swinney. It's just about at what stage would a minister be, you know, reported in a bad way. I mean, you know, is it the initial contact and assessment stage, or would it be the investigation stage? Because I would imagine it would be a bit unfair on a minister if I was, you know, the initial contact and assessment, and then it was ruled by ethics that, you know, there was nothing, you know, that's not a complaint. I don't feel it would be right that that was reported.
Well, that wouldn't, I'll be corrected if I'm wrong here, but that wouldn't register
right
as a complaint, because it wouldn't pass the threshold for consideration.
So
if there's an initial, as Mr. Lumsden will recall, there's an initial consideration undertaken to judge whether or not what has been presented is a substantive complaint that passes the threshold for consideration. If the material did not pass that threshold, it would not be considered a complaint and it would not be reported.
Okay, thanks for that clarification.
Liz?
Just on that same point, am I right that the procedure that would be followed is very similar to one of the Ethics Commissioner, Standards and Ethics Commissioner just now, that if a complaint is made about somebody, he's duty-bound to find out if that complaint should proceed by obviously contacting the person and asking for evidence and asking for evidence from the complainant, and then it's his judgment as to whether it should become a formal complaint. Is that pretty much the same procedure that you're asking for?
It's about an initial consideration of the substance of the issue as to whether it should be considered as a complaint. And there were voices that will say that that provision should not exist and that it should all be considered. But in my judgment, it is appropriate that we have that consideration, given also the context that Liz Smith puts around about other scenarios.
Okay, any other colleagues wish to comment or ask questions? No. Okay, so without further ado, I thank the Cabinet Secretary and his officials for their evidence today, and that concludes today's meeting of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Thank you all for your contributions.